Where did this whole project begin for you?
David, in 1995, I actually started reading Mumia Abu-Jamal's work. His first book was called Live from Death Row. And I was completely taken aback by this guy writing from death row and writing with a poetry and a knowledge that just seemed to be outside of that world. Mm-hmm. And I just slowly, just over, I wasn't thinking about a film, I wasn't thinking about telling his story, I was just turned on by the man's writing. Slowly over the years, I just got to know him and his work better and better and better. In 2006, I was making a film called Murder Incorporated, Empire, Genocide, and Manifest Destiny. And all I was trying to do in an hour and a half was tell the march of the Euro-American Empire from the moment Columbus stepped foot on Hispaniola to George Bush's drone attacks, and by extension, Barack Obama's drone attacks.
Just a brief little piece of history.
I had actually shot about 30 or 40 hours worth of interviews with Howard Zinn and Noam Chomsky and a bunch of different people. And I had asked Mumia to record 25 answers to 25 questions that I had about the subject matter. You know, when Mumia first started writing, he was a smart writer. He wrote about what he knew, and he wrote about the prison industrial complex and his own personal life inside death row in a Pennsylvania gulag. And over the years, he matured as a writer, and you could see his maturation to the point where he was a great critic of the American Empire and American imperialism. He was a perfect person to talk about Murder Incorporated. He recorded these 25 answers, which were some of the most brilliant stuff he's ever done. And I decided to pull the plug on the film for a lot of reasons. One, the film wasn't working. Jumping ahead right now, Mumia and I are actually writing the book together because it works much better as a book than it did as a film. Didn't work as a film at all. Unless we were Oliver Stone on Showtime and we had 10 hours, we could probably pull it off. But I had those, when I decided not to make that film anymore, I had those recordings, and I found in Mumia's life and in the breadth of his life a similar story to Murder Incorporated, but it was a much more personal story. It was a story of a young black man growing up in Philadelphia and feeling the repressive apparatus of the American Empire on his life, and especially on black Americans' life. So it was a fairly easy transition for me, and that was the beginning of the film. I finally decided, my production company funded the film. We started in 2009, and we finished about 3.5 or 4 years later.
So you had no questions about his reality in terms of the actual inciting incident that put him in jail, it seems like?
I was very well aware of the case. I am a firm believer, as are many people, that Mumia is unequivocally, absolutely innocent of the crimes that he's been convicted of and charged with. In fact, on our DVD right now, there is a short film that I produced, because Long Distance Revolutionary doesn't deal with the case. You know, up to this point, David, every film, every book, every article, every video, every live event, like with Rage Against the Machine, dealt with the case. Right. And as a filmmaker, I just didn't want to mine the exact same material. John Edgington for HBO and Channel 4 in the UK did a wonderful job with Case for Reasonable Doubt. A lot of stuff has happened since then, and some of that you will see in Manufacturing Guilt. But I just felt like I wanted to, at least for the DVD, deal with the case, and I kind of just made this 30-minute document that just sort of shows how the Philadelphia police and the DA's office not only manufactured his guilt but concealed his innocence. But it's such a volatile situation with his case, I didn't want to, quite frankly, muck up what I thought was an incredible story of a journalist both prior to and after incarceration writing an incredible body of work. The man has published 8 books from death row. He's written and recorded over 3,000 commentaries from very harsh and draconian conditions on death row. for me as a filmmaker, that's where the story was for me, and how his spirit transcended prison and the impact he's had as a public intellectual, both on political and social discourse around the world.
So that was the basis of everything. That was, sorry, the 25 answers he gave you.
Only about two ended up in the film, and they were just small pieces.
Yeah.
But that was my impetus. You know, that was the what he was talking about and what he was writing about was really what kicked me in the ass to move forward on the film.
So is the answer greater than him, less than him, the same as him? What is the ultimate takeaway for you?
The ultimate takeaway for me, David, is as a society, we're offered a constant diet of war over peace, no health care over health care, horrific education over really good education. And I found a great deal of sanity that was existing in this dark, dank hole on death row, which was offering an alternative to the narrative that I think the American media is offering now and the society in general is offering. And I thought that that was a great juxtaposition to find that kind of truth and that kind of reality and that kind of insight and inspiration coming from someone that literally is living with 20 tons of bricks on him every day.
So in theory, that was him even before the prison, it sounds like.
Absolutely, you know.
And that's why he's driving a cab, as it says in the movie.
Exactly, you know, he was fired from almost every journalism job that he had because he was very uncompromising. What the narrative that has been told over the last 30 years that from people that want to see Mumia fry and they want to just see him hang is that, you know, he shows up in prison, this wild, crazed black murderer from Philadelphia, and decides to become a kind of a cause celebrity and a Johnny-come-lately journalist in prison to save his ass. Mm-hmm. Nothing could be further from the truth. In fact, Buzz Bissinger wrote a hit piece on Mumia in 1999 in Vanity Fair that tried to make that case. We took a big piece of the film to absolutely, I think, destroy Buzz Bissinger and that line of thinking. Mumia was one of the bright up-and-coming stars in American journalism in the late 1970s. He was a reporter for National Public Radio. He was working for All Things Considered. He covered the Ronald Reagan, Jimmy Carter presidential campaign in 1980, and he won a coveted award from Columbia University 3 years before, called the Major Armstrong Award for Journalism from Columbia. So if you look away from the mountain of evidence that's right in front of us, that this man was a budding 28-year-old journalist who people were really looking to, almost thinking that he might be the next Ed Bradley, their narrative just doesn't hold any water whatsoever.
So where do you think they are coming from? I mean, obviously, in the film, there's a fair amount of just anger in a direction, and, you know, and putting down a guy like Buzz. But, I mean, Buzzinger, in many ways, seems to be in the same, I mean, the material is different, but he seems to aspire to kind of the same status that you hold Mumia in a weird way.
Well, you know, sometimes it's when you look behind the curtain, you find different things. Buzz Bissinger is, a lack of a better term, an asshole buddy of Ed Rendell, mm-hmm. who was the governor of Pennsylvania, and at the time he was the district attorney who prosecuted Mumia Abu-Jamal. And he wrote Ed Rendell's biography, or helped an autobiography, something like that. So these guys have been tight. And when this opportunity came up, because in 1998, 1999, Mumia's star was really rising. You know, he had a Hollywood elite establishment behind him. They were questioning every piece of his case. He was really getting traction. And I think this scared the shit out of them. It really, really did. And that piece, it's no coincidence that it ended up in Vanity Fair, and Rendell and Bissinger are like this. So we wanted to make sure that we told what we think is a truthful and alternative narrative. So I think that's where Buzz is coming from. I don't think he was coming from it as an ideologue, or he was coming from a political cronyism, quite frankly.
So the conspiracy is not, it's not really a conspiracy theory so much as a circumstantial situation that has then kind of bloomed out of control, and the people, the cops who are still angry and raging and scaring a lot of people into not saying anything are really just reacting to what they think is reality.
A lot of people made their careers on the back of prosecuting Mumia Abu-Jamal. We have to remember that Philadelphia is probably one of the, used to be called Up South. It's one of the most racist cities in the country. And Mumia had been doing battle with the Philadelphia police, at first as a Black Panther, and then later as a journalist, for well over a decade. They knew who he was, they knew what he was about, and they hated him. In fact, you probably saw in the film, one of the inspectors for the Philadelphia Police Department, George Fendel, every time he would see Mumia out on the street, he would cock his finger and he would just look at him and go like this, "Someday I'm gonna get you." And that's a documented fact, and it happened all the time.
But we're almost a generation away from that now.
Yes, we are.
So, I mean, do you think that that just travels as the folklore within the police department and the community that is pro-police, quote-unquote?
Absolutely. Pro-police and anti-African-American, anti-Black, and also anti-anything that questions the status quo and questions American imperialism. And Mumia does that constantly. And I think that's why they have had their foot on his throat for a very, very long time. And he continues, like I said, with those 20 tons of bricks on him to continue to write and fight as hard as he ever has right now.
Well, see, I mean, for me, it's an interesting balancing question because it's so, it's been such a long time and there's such a clear position on both sides.
Yeah.
It doesn't seem like it's a... I mean, I don't think the side that is anti him feels that, you know, is really as political as a side that's in his favor. I mean, there's a side, it seems to me like the side that's listening to his work, reading his books and everything else, are considering the politics of it and the meaning of it and the subtext of it and everything else. And the other side just thinks the guy is a cop killer. And it doesn't really matter what's true or whether he actually adds anything to the universe or anything except for what they've already kind of decided is the punchline.
Yeah. Well, I think they're actually incredibly political. I think they use the cop killer and kind of this raging violent man as something they want to fly to the top of the flagpole because that's going to sell. But they are as political, if not more political, than the people on the left who continually fight for Mumia's freedom and for justice, because their politics, you know, there's this old saying, law is politics by another name, and or law is politics by other means. And I think from the time that Mumia was a very young man in Philadelphia, he has felt nothing but the political arm of the Philadelphia power establishment and the structure there, just really not only holding Mumia down, but people like the MOVE organization and other people that Mumia was involved with. This was a true street battle in Philadelphia. And in many respects, Mumia sitting in prison shows you just how hard these people are really playing. And they're playing for keeps, and most of them are all alive, so they're not about to take their teeth out of Mumia whatsoever.
But it's a bit of old business in some ways. I mean, it's an interesting.
Yeah, I mean, it does get old, and it's one of the reasons I didn't deal with the case in the film, because that is one of the things. I don't believe it's gotten old for Mumia, because he knows damn well he's innocent, and he wants out of there, and he tries every day to get out of there. But I think that's the reason that I wanted to focus on the part of the story that no one has really ever focused on before. And it's really neat because a lot of times I run into people that have known him since the late 70s, early 80s, either people in his family, friends, adversaries, because we talked during the research, we talked to a number of people who were adversaries. Mm-hmm. And they said, you know, we just never knew this about him. We never knew this. And this is coming from his family members or people that were really dug into him. So I felt good as a filmmaker that we came up, because our research was incredibly in depth. We talked to not only a lot of people on camera, but a lot of people off camera to get a true picture of who this man was from the mid 60s until right at this very moment.
You kind of lead with the negative.
Yeah.
You lead with the people who are, you know, saying he should be in there, he deserves to be in there.
I wanted to get that over with. I wanted the audience to realize how much venom there was out there and kind of use that as a juxtaposition.
So you also have the, conversely, later in the picture, you have the kind of balance of people who have no idea who yeah. he is at this point.
Yeah. It's, and it really has... Mumia's star has absolutely dimmed in the public eye. There's no doubt. After 2000 or so... Mm. It has really kind of subsided. You've seen people who were fighting for years. What happens is when you end up losing a lot, people mm-hmm. start to fall by the wayside. And I never looked at Mumia. I was not drawn to him because of the injustice of his case. I felt it, I knew it, and I was angry about it, but that's not what drew me to him. What mm-hmm. drew me to him was the journalist in him, was the poet in him, the artist in him, and quite frankly right now, the historian that's in him and the important public intellectual that he is, in the same vein that Howard Zinn was, or Noam Chomsky. And that was the light that I wanted to shine on him, because just I can just see from our interview, once we start talking about the case, once we start talking about, you know, why would these people want to do it, it's two guys on both sides of the street throwing rocks at each other. And that's not the story that I saw about Mumia. I knew that it was there, but it was almost it was kind of like Kevin Costner at the beginning of Dances with Wolves, when he just like puts his arms out on the horse and just rides and says, mm-hmm. fuck it, I'm just going to go through these two sides fighting here. I'm not going to mm-hmm. And that's sort of how I felt as a filmmaker, because I heard it from both sides, and I kind of wanted to keep this journey with him on a political and social and intellectual journey, and not on this case that is so corrupt and so skewed that as a filmmaker, I would need 3-4 hours to just, you know, dig through all the crap that's there.
Well, honestly, one of the things that circled around for me as I'm watching the movie is, what if he did do it? Would it matter? I mean, ultimately, to say, you know, hey, hooray for the cop killer would be ridiculous on some level. However, is the aesthetic work of, you know, and the work that he's doing and the political side of it and everything else of significance? I mean, the man clearly has a weight and a significance regardless of this event.
That's right.
What happened.
That's right.
And so it's an interesting, to me, it's almost another layer of interesting to think about, well, you know, is this act, if it happened, is all this, is it still wrong to try to bury that voice and to not hear it because you think he had some wrong in his past?
Yeah. I hear that all the time. Again, and I said it before, I unequivocally, absolutely believe Mumia is innocent. Not only believe it, I know it. But the point that we have over 2 million people in prisons right now, that's an entire nation behind bars in this country. And there are voices in there. And not just Mumia's voices, there are mm-hmm. other people. You know, I've been in on death row mm-hmm. with Mumia. And all I can tell you is when you see some of these dudes in there, thank God there are prisons. I mean, because there are loads of guilty people inside the prisons. But there are also voices in there that need to be heard. The population, we have this prison industrial complex in this country where we are spending billions and billions and billions of dollars. We're privatizing these prisons. They're becoming more and more corrupt. You saw what happened in Abu Ghraib. A lot of the guards in Abu Ghraib, Charles Grainer, who was one of mm-hmm. the really bad guards there, was one of Mumia's guards at SCI Green in Pennsylvania. I mean, mm-hmm. it's a great proving ground and training ground for these guys to go overseas and kind of carry that legacy with them, if we want to call it a legacy. Mm-hmm. Those voices need to be heard, because, you know, if we didn't have the pictures at Abu Ghraib, we wouldn't know what happened there. Well, if we don't have voices telling us about what's going on mm-hmm. inside of American prisons, all hell is going to break loose. All hell already is breaking loose. Mumia is one of those voices, and I think that, you know, in some people's minds, innocent or guilty, those voices still need to be heard.
So that's, I mean, I think that's the crux of it, besides the, you know, going back in time and if this happened, then this happened kind of conversation.
Yeah.
The idea of that people are not open to the conversation. The extent of the conversation stops at cop killer. That's the only thing they can say.
Yeah.
And then there's no communication about the ideas that are at issue.
Yeah.
And I think that that's probably true in every direction and every issue in this country right now, that people are not listening to each other because they're too busy being dogmatic about some event, some idea, some thing that's much more simplistic in a way, even though person's dead, obviously, than this bigger conversation.
Yeah, and it was very important.
On both sides. I mean, I think the right has things to say also.
Absolutely.
That I don't necessarily agree with, but that I, you know, I want to hear.
Yeah.
But just
and
saying,
I would lay down in traffic for their right to say whatever it is that they're going to say. Absolutely.
When all they want to say is the left is evil, it doesn't really, that's not helping the conversation either, and doesn't help when we on the left are saying the same thing in the other direction. There's nowhere to go.
That's right.
So is this kind of a big bell on the hill to remind everybody that Mumia is there and to pay attention again?
You know, when I set out to make the film, David, probably hear this from a lot of filmmakers, I just wanted to make a good story. I just wanted to tell a good story, and I thought this was a really good story. Did I have a political agenda? I think any filmmaker, especially making a political film, that tells you that they don't have an agenda is full of shit. We all have agendas. I don't care, you know, if you just turn the camera on and you just, it's cinema verite, there is an agenda to what you wanna. So yes, I came at it from a point of view that was very supportive of Mumia's political point of view. Does that mean that the research wasn't done? Does that mean that there's not one piece of this film that I would stand behind as being, you know, absolutely vetted in the truth? Absolutely. We really worked hard. Mm-hmm. It's an alternative narrative to what has been told for the last 30 years. And the other side, quite frankly, has had 30 years to spin this as much as they can, and the mainstream media, like they are apt to do, or lapdogs, and they just roll over and play dead and they just repeat it. This is kind of a cold splash in their face to maybe, as you say, to say, yeah, he's still here, he's still fighting, and he's still relevant because he's still calling the American government and the American empire out on their behavior, not only in this country, but around the world.
Mm. And the conversation in the movie about him not having the internet or access or whatever, what does he have access to?
Absolutely nothing. He has access to what we send him. For instance, I'm writing this book with him now. Mm-hmm. I have to send him every article, every book, every journal. When it comes to books and journals, I can't send it to him personally. I have to use Amazon or Barnes & Noble or whoever has it. It has to come in through a bona fide bookseller. He has no computer. He has no email. He has no internet. He's doing it old school, the old-fashioned way, and he does his research. He's a voracious reader and a voracious writer. And
so how does he stay connected with what's happening in the world? It sounds like he must.
Well, he gets an awful lot of help from people that are supportive of him. I mean, you know, if I see articles, I will drop them in FedEx to him. I will drop them in the mail to him. He does have some television now. For a long time, he had no television. But now he's able to, you know, he's able to watch some of the news, which I know he gets a kick out of. He likes to get USA Today because he told me that it just gives him TV Guide versions of the news without having to get in too deep, so he can keep his own perspective on things and then
That's
do the research about that. But he reads and he reads and he reads, and I think that it's, you know, I'm writing half the chapters and he's writing half the chapters in this book, and you know, I'm on my computer and I can just, everything's at my fingertips, you know, and you know, there's a lot of garbage on the internet, but if you know where you're looking, you're coming in and I can get it instantaneously. And I sometimes wonder how the hell he does it, because I get his chapters, he mails them to me. They're not only brilliant, but they're so well researched. The citations, he'll have hundreds of citations for a chapter. He just, you know, he just, the computer to him doesn't mean anything because he doesn't know what it is.
I never heard anybody actually promote USA Today as perfect because it's so shallow.
It's so shallow, it helps him out.
Because he's able to get the best paper in the world. It says absolutely nothing. Just the facts, ma'am.
Yeah.
So, you paid for this.
Mm-hmm.
You did not go out and fundraise. You didn't go out looking for people to get involved.
I hate that. That's why I got out of narrative filmmaking.
Well, everybody hates it, but
everybody
people have
hates
to do it,
it
usually.
Now, the last two films, I've been very fortunate. My production company, Street Legal Cinema, we're kind of it's a balance of art and commerce. We have a great deal of commercial clients that we end up mm-hmm. doing a lot of great work for, and I'm able to take some of those profits and fund the documentaries that I'd like to make. So this was, I did not have a suit tied around my neck, which was, and this was a, quite frankly, it's a hackneyed expression, but it was a labor of love. The next film mm-hmm. I'm doing is on Abbie Hoffman, and we are actively seeking financing right now. We just started going out with it. So I can only finance one of these every 5 or 6 years, I guess.
So you're in the slightly better dressed sales department. John Sayles.
Yeah, exactly. John Sayles.
Who basically yeah. works to make his movies.
Yeah, from my home state of New Jersey.
There you go.
Yeah.
So the next project will be a bigger, more expensive project? Is that the reason why you're funding
no,
it?
No. It might be a little bit more money, but no, I'm just not in a position to want to. The last film I did was One Bright Shiny Moment, The Forgotten Summer of George McGovern. Street Legal Cinema financed that film. We financed mm-hmm. the Mumia film. So we're going to go in a partnership.
Make some money.
We're going to go in a partnership, make some money on this one, yeah.
Not suffer quite as much.
Yeah.
So when you get to the distribution part of it, is that a giant hurdle? Is that the hard part, or are you terribly worried about it at that point?
With the Mumia film?
Yeah.
I wasn't actually, because I have a really good relationship with First Run Features in New York City. Mm-hmm. And they distributed my last film. They knew about this film. Mm-hmm. We went to some festivals, but I struck the deal with First Run Features for the theatrical release and the entire U.S. and Canadian release mm-hmm. and all markets with First Run Features. They've done a fantastic job. I mean, we've been in 20 or 25 cities. The Starz Television Network just acquired all the rights to the film for 2 years. We're on iTunes, Netflix in a number of months, and now we're moving out into Europe and around the world. So actually we're doing very well in Germany. We've been in 15 theaters in Germany in the last month and a half, so we're very happy with that. But distribution for this was not a problem whatsoever, and First Run really put themselves behind the film. And you know, we opened in New York on February 1. We were number 3 in the country. We opened in LA. We were number 1, and we've played a lot of other cities. So we were held over in both of those cities. So that was really nice.
So you're good with the current state of distribution in the indie world, I guess.
No, I'm not. I'm not good with it. I think it's horrific. But First Run,
okay,
I've sort
you.
Of found an oasis for myself. But I think that it's, I've had a lot of people, they think that because we're not in a lot of theaters, because I know we're in a lot, because as you know, most documentaries don't get into theaters. Mm-hmm. And they'll think that we're being kept out of theaters because it's Mumia. And they're looking for some kind of a conspiracy thing.
Right.
With people. I tell them, no, it's a conspiracy against documentarians, quite frankly. And that's 90% of what it is. Sure, there's a political thing going on,
right.
A little bit, but it isn't a conspiracy. It's really very difficult to make money. I mean, I'll go to the theater night when the movie's there and there's 4 people in the theater, you mm-hmm. know. So, but when we were in New York, I had a great little story. I'll tell you real quick. A good friend of mine is Alex Gibney. We've produced a couple of films together, and we had a couple of sold out performances in New York back to back, and he had his hockey movie was in the same cinema mm-hmm. village, and there were about 3 or 4 people in there. So I sent him an email to make sure he knew that we were sold out and he had 4 people in his movie, and he wrote me back kind of a nasty retort. So I was okay.
Alex, is that possible?
No, it's not possible.
Not remotely possible. So it's you found something that works for you, and you found it, you know, you're happy with First Run, you're happy with the way this has gone, pretty
yeah,
much.
Yeah, very much so, yeah.
But are you concerned about the lack of theatrical, or do you think that there's a place for a VOD, ultimately subscription-driven documentary thing that'll create enough revenue to make these viable for people to do?
Yes, I really do. I think Netflix is already doing that right now. I mean, they've just started financing documentaries. In fact, we're going to start talking to them about the Abbie Hoffman film. And but yeah, I think that just like technology has democratized the system for filmmakers as far as, you know, cameras and editing equipment and, mm-hmm. and allowing a lot of filmmakers to make films that, you know, a couple of decades ago or even 10 years ago, they couldn't have even touched from a budgetary standpoint. Mm-hmm. I think distribution will follow suit a bit too, because there will be more outlets for filmmakers / journalists to make films that larger companies just can't find the profit in. And I understand that. I know how difficult it is to make money with these things. It's really difficult. It's kind of a chicken and an egg thing too, because the audience doesn't come out. They say they want this stuff. They say they want this stuff, but they don't show up to the theaters. They don't go to iTunes. It's really difficult. You know, social media has helped us a great deal mm-hmm. with you know, DVD sales and iTunes and those things. So that's been a blessing. But I think that video on demand can help out tremendously for documentarians and for low budget films of, you know, projects of, you know, all types.
And you don't mind if people see it on their television versus the theatrical screen?
Sure, I mind a little bit. I really do. You know, I think it was David Lynch. I saw him railing one day about people watching his movies on phones and iPads and stuff. And I agree with that, even though I'm somewhat guilty of it. You know, I'll watch things. I won't watch it on a phone. I'll watch it on an iPad. I won't go down to that. Sure. I mean, when I see this film on the big screen and it's being projected from a DCP and it's 5.1 audio, mm-hmm. yeah, I'm in heaven. You know, when I watch it on television or I see it somewhere else on television, the TV's screwed up and the sound is awful. Yeah, it hurts, but I've gotten over it, because sometimes I'll watch something with my wife and I'll say, well, did you hear that sound? It was, she didn't hear anything. You know, yeah. So I say, you know what? I got to let go a little bit. You know, but sure, I would much rather it be in a theater. I think that, and with Mumia, it's been great because the screenings and the showings are like an event. They're a little bit like, you know, it's kind of like a little piece of Woodstock coming out. People come out and they want to be there. So that makes it even transcends it being a film. It's sort of a moment where they can be together and kind of celebrate this man's life.
And is there any chance that Mumia will actually see the film?
As to this point, no. We had this weird thing where we were going to sell it to the Black Entertainment Network, BET, because he gets that on his on his cable, and we were going to, but that didn't work out. They weren't paying very much, but either is anybody really. Mm. But I don't know if he's ever going to see it. It's you know, I would hope he sees it when he gets out, and if that happens, that would be great.
But he's not allowed to be shown it.
No. Now, I've mentioned to the attorneys, I said, you know, this film very much is kind of like a character witness for Mumia. You know, I said, maybe we should bring it on an iPad, try to get the prison to go along with that. But mm-hmm. when it comes to Mumia, the prison will not go along with anything.
Mm. Even though I'm sure he's a fairly ideal prisoner at this point.
In fact, he's a very ideal, very well respected, gets along with the guards. I mean, this is not somebody with any kind of... Mumia does not have a behavior problem. He does not need to go to anger management. He is one of the softest, most easiest going people I've ever met. In fact, his sister in the movie, I think, calls him a big teddy bear. And that's really what he is. He's a very, very peaceful man. One of the reasons that December 9th, 1981 just did not happen.